So I have 8:30 now, and let me welcome you to session 222, Scientific Advances in Thermodynamics. Our first speaker this morning is Professor Giovanni Galavotti from Sapienza University of Rome. The title of his talk is A Path from Equilibrium to Non-Equilibrium Thermodynamics. Professor Galavotti.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for the invitation. I am honored. So I will talk about some recent developments, quite recent developments on extending thermodynamics from equilibrium to non-equilibrium. I start here by quoting the beginning of the book of Carnot, where he says that everybody knows that heat can be the cause of motion, even with great power. As the machines available today, that is 1814 or so, prove. So on the basis of properties of the rarefied gases, Carnot develops in this book his theorem on the ideal efficiency of machines operating by extracting heat from some reservoir and converting throwing it in some other and converting that the difference into work. The theorem shows that the most efficient machines must be operate running in a cycle in which vapor of water or air or alcohol or other liquid or solid materials evolve through a sequence P of equilibrium states. Reversible transformation were essential in Carnot analysis, and he carefully insists to clarify the subtle argument that permits to avoid regarding their definition, requiring, for instance, a difference in temperature, which can be considered as vanishing, an oxymoron. He says, and then develops the concept, that in fact, things cannot be like that. Okay, so that is the beginning of thermodynamics, essentially. A few years later, Koenig established the proportionality of absolute temperature to average kinetic energy, and Clausius wrote the first of the works leading to entropy in 1850, whose existence constitutes the second law of thermodynamics and is implied by Carnot's theorem. If through a path of P, a system reversibly evolves from a state A to a state P via successive equilibria, then the entropy variation is SP minus SA, the sum of the quantities of heat that are absorbed at temperature T along the path. And this allows to set the value of the entropy of a generic equilibrium state, determining it up to an additive constant. Entropy, however, is important also in irreversible processes. Clausius, in such a process, I, shows that the variation of the entropy is bigger or equal than the same quantity that I have quoted before. But the matter is constituted by atoms subject to mechanical laws, and therefore the question arises or arose, which is the mechanical interpretation of entropy, hence of thermodynamics. In 1866, Boltzmann proposed to link it to the purely mechanical Maupertuis action principle, imagining atoms moving on a single periodic orbit, spanning all phase space points compatible with mechanical conservation laws. Okay, the continuous use of the second law, hence of Carnot theorem, led to harsh debates on the ergodic hypothesis, which is this visiting all points of phase space, on entropy and on the resolution of the antinomy, reversible microscopic dynamics and irreversible macroscopic evolutions, which in some respects is still going on. It cannot be denied that in an adiabatic expansion of a gas, even perfect, the gas will settle on a new equilibrium. The entropy variation is easily computed to be strictly positive, because because the transformation is adiabatic. So the gas evolves via reversible dynamics to a state from which it cannot return. And that this is an apparent paradox which anguished a lot of people, including myself. Okay. Boltzmann and Thomson clearly pointed out the need to consider the time scale for the return to the initial state under the impossible invariability of the conditions of the experiment for a time far longer than the time elapsed since the birth of the universe. And it can be said that the problem is no longer considered one, at least by a large part of scientists. Attention evolved to inquire about the possibility of extending thermodynamics to cover phenomena which seem natural generalizations of the equilibria. Namely, phenomena in which external forces drive systems which, being in contact with thermostats, evolve towards a stationary state, which is not an equilibrium state, because work of the external forces is dissipated into the thermostats. The question is then, is it possible to associate with each stationary state of a system quantities like energy, pressure, temperature, entropy, among which exist general relations, possibly simple and universal, as it is the case if attention is restricted to equilibrium states? A major step has been non-Sager reciprocity for the transport coefficients. It led to extended thermodynamics to the new stationary phenomena, with the non-Sager reciprocity being the first new universal system independent relations that were obtained. However, non-Sager reciprocity concerns quantities expressing initial deviation from equilibrium. Strictly mathematically, these are the concerns derivatives with respect to the forcing intensity evaluated at zero value. One would like to see what happens under more general situations and to reach generality and universality comparable to that of equilibrium thermodynamics. The modern approach has been to rely on statistical mechanics, in a way giving up the idea of building a theory of non-equilibrium phenomena on purely microscopic grounds. Even though restricted only to stationary states. So even though you want to consider only stationary states, which is the natural extension of equilibrium. Statistical mechanics of equilibrium thermodynamics is based on the theory of ensembles, to which equilibrium state is associated with a probability distribution, which is a synonym of ensemble, which is another word which has several interpretations, but here ensemble is a probability distribution, which allows you to compute the time average, the average value in time of the few interesting observables, say pressure, density, energy, and temperature, but not for all, far from all. Just as in thermodynamics, the number of observables are limited. Even entropy admits an expression in terms of the equilibrium probability distribution. Now, is it possible to build a similar theory of ensembles, which means families of probability distribution functions depending on the macroscopic parameters determining the properties of the stationary states of a system, which means determining the average values of all the observables of interest, which are, I stress, they are not too many. You know, when in a system with 10 to the 23 particles, it is very difficult to take care of all observables. The connection now, which are the difficulties in this direction? One is the connection between thermodynamics and statistical mechanics is via the ergodic hypothesis. Roughly, motion visits a dense set on phase space. This is not the mathematical definition of ergodicity, but that is what was intended at the time these things were developed. And in equilibrium, there is only one or few reasonable probability distribution functions on phase space, which is invariant and does not change in time, so that it can describe the frequencies of a visit to a phase space cell delta in equilibrium in an equilibrium state. So there are why do I say that these are difficulties? I will explain in the next slide. But stress once more, thermodynamics and statistical mechanics are related by the ergodic hypothesis, density of motion in phase space, and the existence of only one reasonable PDF. I mean, this pair of assumptions is very well discussed in a paper by Maxwell in 1879, which was one of his last works, because that was the year he died, and he really stresses these points. Now, what is the next? Now, what the assumption one can be accepted, perhaps, but in equilibrium, but certainly cannot in non-equilibrium. That's why it is a difficulty. Simply because the presence of driving and the corresponding dissipation imply that at stationarity, only a subset of the a priori available phase space points, which means compatible with the constraints and conservation laws, is visited. When you have strong dissipation, the system goes towards an attracting set and an attractor, and which is really smaller than phase space. For instance, it has zero volume. The assumption two relies on Liouville's theorem. So once you accept that the motion is dense on phase space, it was believed at the beginning, and in Boltzmann this is very clear, that there is only one distribution which has the property of being invariant under time evolution, and this comes out of Liouville's theorem. So by Liouville's theorem, you have only one, you may think that you have only one invariant probability distribution, in spite of the fact that the motion, the evolution, strongly deforms any volume in phase space without changing its volume. Which is strange to think, to give an argument which singles out the Liouville measure because of that. It has become very clear that the Liouville volume is not, by any means, the only way of measuring volumes delta, which is invariant under the mechanical evolution, and therefore suitable to be interpreted as a frequency of visit to a cell delta in phase space. Therefore, the often invoked argument that the microcanonical ensemble, which is the uniform distribution on the energy surface, is privileged, fails. And the problem remains even for the equilibria, as for the microscopic interpretation of thermodynamics. A solution is which is essentially due to Ruelle answers, I have here some references at the end of the slides, answers the above two questions. And it relies on the some key properties of chaotic motions. Now, a motion is chaotic if most pairs of closed initial data separate at an exponential rate. As in the theory of order, now this is an interesting point in my opinion, as in the theory of ordered motions, we use the paradigm of harmonic oscillators to explain their motions. Like when you try to model the pendulum motion, the elastic chains, elastic strings, integrable systems, rigid body with fixed point or not fixed. And likewise, in the theory of chaotic motions, there is a paradigm which is essentially able to interpret all the phenomena of chaos, which are relevant for systems which consist of, which are really complex, which of interest in thermodynamics, for instance. And it is the hyperbolic motion. The hyperbolic motion is a very simple example, which is, in my opinion, the analog of the harmonic oscillator for regular motions. and these are the Anosov systems, which entered the scene of physics in the 1960s. Like the harmonic oscillator case, their properties are very elementary, although not really well known yet in the field. And that is an unfortunate thing, because they are very often you find people that say, okay, this is abstract mathematics and so on. No, it's I mean, it is as abstract as an harmonic oscillator, except that it describes chaos. Remarkably, because chaos is, in principle is something that you cannot order easily, but the hyperbolic systems, in particular the Anosov systems, which are a subclass of them, like the harmonic oscillator are a subclass of the systems which have regular motions, these are systems which are very simple and elementary. Elementarily describable. In great generality, the property of such systems, and this is an essential property of the chaotic systems, which come from hyperbolicity of the motion, which is a typical case for systems which are complex, is that if the initial data x are chosen with a distribution rho x dx on phase space, which has a density rho, no matter which rho is, and this is very important, no matter which rho is, will evolve in time, visiting when t becomes large, any number fixed element delta with the frequency mu of delta, which is independent of rho. So typically you have in mind that you prepare an experiment in which you produce an initial data, x, and this data typically is concentrated on something which is macroscopically a very precise point. Just to make an example, you take a gas in a box and compress the gas on a little cube on a side, and then let it go. Now, independently of where you compress it, if the motion of the gas is chaotic, as typically is, you will go to the same mu of delta, the same frequency of visit of a given volume element, of any given volume element delta. And this is remarkable, even when the evolution is very dissipative and the motions approach an attractor, which is far from dense in phase space. I'm thinking, for instance, of a fluid enclosed in a box, which is described, say, by Navier-Stokes equations, and the phase space which is allowed to visit to the microscopic points, or even to the velocity field, is extremely small compared to all possibilities that you have for the velocity field. The velocity field acquires a special structure, which is well known in turbulence theory. This gives the possibility of solving this uniqueness of the frequencies for data which are chosen with a distribution which has density. It gives the possibility of solving both problems 1 and 2 above. Let me remind you which are the two problems. One is that the ergodic hypothesis is doubtful, as you well know, already for equilibrium, and it cannot be easily accepted when you have dissipation, because the system certainly does not visit the whole free space. And furthermore, out of equilibrium, you do not have this nice thing that you have an obvious invariant probability distribution, which allows you to interpret it as a frequency of visit. Now, these two problems are solved essentially via the proposals that Ruelle introduced in the early 70s. Now, Emotion, let me just remind that emotion is considered chaotic if most pairs of close initial data separate at an exponential rate, which is the Lyapunov response. Okay, so sorry, I had reached, I think, this point. So I want to illustrate how to solve the two problems. So the first assumption should be willing to make is that any laboratory experiment is based on a protocol to set up the initial data. Inevitably, the protocol generates initial states which have some randomness, which depends on the protocol. Even for the same experiment, you change a little bit the way you prepare the initial data, and the initial data change in a substantial way. In spite of the attempts that you may want, you usually provide to avoid uncertainty. The basic assumption is that a given protocol generates data which depend on several unknown quantities. And nevertheless, all protocols designed to study a given system are supposed to have some randomness expressible as a PDF, which has a density on free space. Density is not known, and there is no way to know it, as much as there is no way to know the exact position of the atoms in a box. But the assumption is that it exists. Let me say it formally, a protocol for an experiment on a system produces initial data affected by uncertainty whose PDF has a density in free space. Experimentalists neglect the fact that there is the data are so carefully prepared, and that one can neglect the fact that there is some noise in the data. And second, if the evolution is chaotic, which is generally the case, then it is hyperbolic evolution, and this is the second assumption, if you like. In the vicinity of the attractor, the evolution is hyperbolic. This is not on the full phase space, but just on the attractor. So this applies also to dissipative systems. Okay, the property B, which I call chaos, and the property A, which says unknown but existent randomness of initial data, solves the problem of frequency mu delta of visits to the sets delta, and it solves it uniquely and this is a theorem on chaotic evolution. It's just like the theorem that ordered motions are typically quasi-periodic motions, so they can be decomposed into finitely many harmonics. And in the case of conservative systems, it identifies the Liouville volume as the privileged volume measure. The Liouville volume, therefore, is not privileged because it stands obviously out of the wide variety of invariant volumes that exist, and they have equal rights, since the only requirement for a stationary distribution is that its PDF should be stationary, should be invariant under time. But as soon as the system exhibits chaotic motions, the data which are chosen with some probability distribution which has a density on free space evolve to the same PDF as far as the computation of the average of the observables is concerned. So Liouville volume is not privileged because it stands obviously. I remember to have been told many times that this was a good reason for choosing the Liouville volume as giving the probability distribution for the computation of the averages. But I'm saying here that it is not privileged because of that, but it's rather privileged because the data that you choose have intrinsically some randomness with a PDF, which is typically not invariant, like when the initial state is gas compressed in a corner of a box, but which has a density on phase space. And that is, so this is the key, these two assumptions, which I think are the basics of the proposal by Ruel, have a very remarkable fact that they unify equilibrium and non-equilibrium. In both cases, the motions are chaotic, and in both cases, the averages need to be computed using a probability distribution which is uniquely determined a priori by the simple fact that the initial data are chosen with some distribution which you don't know, and there you have no way to know, but which is the density on phase space. So, whether in equilibrium or in stationary non-equilibrium, the states of the system are identified with a well-defined collection of probability distributions. Now, this is well known to happen. No, sorry, I must say. Yes. Okay. So the fact that you have well-defined distributions which allow you to compute averages is well known in equilibrium. And in equilibrium, it is well known that you can have several distributions which provide the same averages to the that they can be put in correspondence, so that corresponding PDFs assign the same distribution to the values of the few observables of interest. So this is an important point, because once you see this correspondence, this correspondence with equilibrium, then it comes to your mind that is just as in equilibrium, it is possible that for macroscopic systems, the same stationary states can be described by different probability distributions, which however assign the same distribution the fluctuations of values observables of interest. As we see, not only a unification between equilibrium and non-equilibrium stationary, but also we see the possibility of the occurrence of several ensembles which describe the states of the system and the corresponding theory of their equivalence. This is a totally new fact in non-equilibrium. And it was well known in equilibrium, but it is not so in non-equilibrium, and it's only follows from the two assumptions that I said above. The question is then whether the above general views can be subject to tests. So can you test all this? Starting in the 1980s, there have been many tests on the chaotic evolutions in systems with statistical mechanics relevance. Although not rarely, the authors have made clear, at least implicitly, that they were not following the ideas A and B. Well, still the results presented by them were actually confirming the view. Among the results that have been obtained, let me quote a few. The extension of the green cubo formula by Ruel, so on circular reciprocity they extended a little above zero forcing, its application to atmospheric phenomena, a very large number of simulations at small as well as large forcings. There are books in the literature which discuss these simulations, the development of distinct ensembles that represent the same phenomena. In particular, it has become clear that two different equations of motion can describe the same macroscopic evolution. For reversible evolutions, the fluctuations of the entropy production over time tau have been shown to obey a universal law, the so-called fluctuation theorem, which can be regarded as a generalization of Onsager reciprocity. Existence of dissipation has been shown to be interpretable as a consequence of the things that I've just quoted, to be interpretable in some cases as a spontaneous breaking of symmetry, opening possibly the way to the extension of the fluctuation theorems to irreversible evolutions, and all the questions about the equivalence of the ensembles. Finally, a key question is whether it is possible to define a state function which extends to non-stationary equilibria the notion of entropy. There is debate on the question because the formula S equal K log W does not have an obvious extension to non-equilibrium steady states, even if steady. W is the Liouville volume of the phase space invaded by the evolution of a generic initial datum, which in equilibrium is the whole phase space available compatible with the constraints. But out of equilibrium, the frequency mu of delta of visit to a volume delta is in general not expressible by Liouville volume, nor by an integral over delta of a non-constant density. It is just a quantity mu of delta, which is not an integral of a density. In mathematics, one says it is concentrated on a set of zero volume. Okay, so this question, of course, comes up immediately, and you can find the discussion discussed in the literature. And there are controversies, so it is better not to enter into them here, because it is a problem here, or should be left for discussion in a different talk. So this is essentially all I wanted to say. Let me just add some remarks about this entropy. So when entropy is defined up to a set of zero volume, but just as you see from this formula, S equal K log W depends on W from the units of measure of the volume in phase space. And so we change the units to an additive constant. Now, there have been many attempts to extend this notion to stationary states out of equilibrium. The one that I prefer, but it is a subject of discussion, is to relate it again to the frequency mu of delta of visit to a volume delta, which in general is not an integral of a density. And the arbitrary additive constant, which you meet in equilibrium, out of equilibrium becomes an additive quantity, which depends on the units of measurement as in equilibrium. But the dependence contains the parameters that describe the state. So it is not an arbitrary additive constant. It is an additive quantity which depends in a non-trivial way from the state of the system. Still, it may have the property that it has a maximum value on the unique stationary distribution that is guaranteed to exist by the assumptions on causticity. But this is only a hint to another talk that I think here is not the place. Here I just want to stress the new point of view which emerges from Ruelle's work is that motions are chaotic and the initial data and the uniqueness of the frequencies of visit to points in phase space, to volumes in phase space, is guaranteed by the hyperbolicity assumption for the motion on the attractor. Well, I think I finished. I want to thank you for listening. And if there are questions, I could answer perhaps. Still, I saved a few minutes.
Thank you very much, Dr. Galavotti. We do have 10 minutes before the scheduled next talk.
Yes, but I have a question.
Shall we have questions now, Ram? How would you like to proceed?
Yeah, let's have a question answer now.
Okay, for the next 10 minutes. Yes.
Yes. I think it's very interesting, this exploration of these fields. I have problems in identifying concrete situations where we can apply that. I wonder if you could relate us some of experimental situations or of real life situations where those ideas could be tested.
Yes, as I mentioned quite a few points. For instance, well, there is a large number of simulations, for instance, in which properties of thermodynamic nature, like transport coefficients, have been studied. And from these simulations, it emerged something that I mentioned, not only that that the points A and B were, of course, occurring, but it emerged also. It emerged also the possibility of using different equations to describe the same system, and remarkably, the possibility of using for a system which has obvious dissipative nature to use a reversible equation instead, and still obtain the same result. There are many results of this type since the 80s, and by Nozay Hoover, by Evans Morris, and later by other people, but really a large number. And I have been working in this context on studying Navier-Stokes equations. So what I propose in that context is that you can replace the equation of Navier-Stokes by another equation which is reversible, unlike Navier-Stokes, and which still gives the same expectation values to functions of the velocity field. But this is published papers which I added at the end of this, but there are also other applications. For instance, let me see. It is a strange situation because there are many claims in the literature that for instance, the fluctuation theorem, which is a particular result obtained in this context, which works for reversible systems, which are chaotic, is claimed to have been tested. Now, if I have examined many of these papers, there are literally hundreds of papers which try to check this fluctuation relation, which is a universal relation for the fluctuations of the entropy production of the system in a stationary state. What I remark is that very few, but really very, very few of them really make a test of what the fluctuation theorem says. They test something that they believe is predicted by this theorem, but in fact they don't. And that is annoying because this means simply that people don't read the papers. The interesting thing is that in the numerical simulations instead, these properties are really tested. So there is the experimentalists should be a little bit more attentive to the theory before claiming that they have tested it, because the predictions of this theorem are very, very nice. They are kind of they give you a system independent relation between larger and fluctuations of entropy production and its opposite, and that is impressive if you see the pictures. But one should be careful that one is really testing what one is claiming to be testing. So other applications, there are many systems which you can study theoretically. For instance, chains of rotators. you can do a rather detailed theory of those systems and check that they verify the assumptions. And all this is published. I mean, I think in the end, I quoted a book of mine in which I make a collection of these results. But it's a really long story. So it's and the remarkable thing is that it is very controversial. But I think you should make your own judgment about this story.
Are there other questions?
Giovanni, I'd like to ask just a general question. Do you see the application of either the Ansinger relations or Navier-Stokes equations being scaled up to the social level?
Well, I hope so. At least I have had, I must say that I had, it was not easy to get one paper published, but in the end, you can read it in the literature. Yes, I hope it will. You know, why I was interested in Navier-Stokes? Well, Navier-Stokes is typically an irreversible equation. So then you start, it was derived by Maxwell. And you look at Maxwell, and you see that in Maxwell, the viscosity, the viscosity, nu, is an average. Is obtained as an average force. So it's not true that on each molecule you have marked how much is the viscosity. The viscosity is a collective phenomenon, but it arises in a system, or at least you can imagine that it arises in a system in which motion is reversible. So my idea was simply, then it should be possible to describe the same phenomenon, viscosity, via a reversible equation. Okay, I have proposed a different equation, which looks the same as Navier-Stokes, except that in place of the viscosity, it has a coefficient, which I call alpha, which depends on the velocity field, which is designed so that the total dissipation is a constant. You know, it is well known that in Navier-Stokes equation, the main for instance, in three dimensions, the main problem is the fact that you don't control the dissipation. The modification of the equation is very trivial, but you impose the value of this coefficient alpha, which replaces the viscosity in such a way that the total dissipation is an exact constant. In other words, instead of having an exactly constant viscosity, you have an exactly constant dissipation. And then the claim is that the large scale observables, which means the observables which depend on Fourier modes, which are less or equal than some quantity that you prefix, have the same statistical behavior in the two equations, and I have published a paper which does that, which shows that this is the case in a very special case. I am trying to convince other people to repeat the experiment and to study it in three dimensions, and something is beginning to appear in the literature, but it is a very long story. But if it has anything to do with as I believe, with reality, that shows that once more you can describe the same system with different equations, right? Which is particularly interesting in the case the system is has a phenomenological origin, like the Navier-Stokes equations. I don't know if that is is a. I mean, that's what I can say about that.
Okay, there will be time, I think, for more questions at the end of the session. Right now, I think we should move on to the next talk.